to start somewhere. It has to start sometime. What better place than here? What better time than now?
Yeah.
She made a lot of money.
All right, we're back. Two Hotheads Where Activism Happens on Unregular Radio.
Well, as usual, we're discussing stuff off air. That's even. did they hear us?
No. Oh. No. I think I saved it. I think we're good.
Thank you. We'll listen back later.
Yeah.
But, yeah, what are we doing now?
we're having
spirit. Newman's laughing at us. Yeah, Newman, laugh louder.
I'm laughing.
Get next to the mic when you laugh
at us. I'm laughing directly at you.
Oh, at me. Okay.
Nah, I'm just kidding.
He's relaxing right now because he used to be in the hot
seat. Let's hear of a Newman.
Producer.
Can we give a clap of Newman being here?
Oh,
again?
Please. Keep going.
Yeah. Newman did this for so long. He even dealt with it. He's got for free.
How does it feel being able to chill?
It's weird, but it's a good thing. I mean, it's a totally different perspective.
It's something you helped create.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's going good now.
Yeah, you guys are doing all right, man. You're really good.
You were there. If it wasn't for you and Carm and you know, the station getting behind it, this show wouldn't have lasted.
It's grown so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Newman.
I should leave everything I do. It just goes really well after that.
Oh, shit.
If you had left at the wrong time, though.
No.
I think you left that a good time.
Yeah.
We can get him back. Come on.
Oh,
right?
He will be back. Oh. I'm actually. That's the thing, Newman. You can't leave
not
today without
enough,
me lobbying you. I might have something for you.
We'll work
on it. We need to talk before you leave today.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, speaking of, so we have other friends in the studio as well. Alex Arsenal just walked in after having a day volunteering with the Yes on 3 campaign. So welcome, Alex. How you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm doing great. How are you?
Wonderful.
Lovely.
Absolutely.
All right.
You got to tell us about what you did this afternoon. Also, voter registration. And I hear there was some controversy about Mr. Mike Cann.
Not me.
So, no. Well,
this one. This one not about me. It was about Alex, wasn't it?
I can put all this voter registration controversy to rest.
Let's hear it. Because I think it was already like.
All right,
Facebook.
Let me talk about what I was. Let's talk right, about something a little go. More important first.
No.
I was doing today.
With the
Yes on 3 campaign. We were calling out to everyone, letting everyone know that the Yes on 3 campaign is going to be doing a lot of stuff between now and Election Day. Two things you guys got to know out there is that we have bumper stickers and we have lawn signs. We've got lots of them. You can get bumper stickers and lawn signs for free mailed to your house from the Yes on 3 campaign.
That's incredible. That's awesome.
If you want a bumper sticker or a lawn sign mailed to you, just email the Massachusetts Patients Advocacy Alliance their email address. I'm going to give you a second to get a pen here.
Put down the joint.
Pick up a pen.
The joint is not a pen.
It could be. You could write with a joint, but it wouldn't be that legible.
Yeah, you might burn the paper.
All right. Email them at mjpatients@gmail.com. Very easy to remember. Just send them your address. Tell them, be like, hey, I want bumper stickers. I want yard signs. They'll get them to you. They're here. We got to get them out. There's only three weeks left
before the election. What if I send that I need them? Will they send them to
me? They will send them to you.
Are you sure?
Yes.
They're not that mad at me?
No. They will be happy to send you bumper stickers and lawn signs.
MJPatients@gmail.com. Awesome, good to know. So wait, are they the Yes on 3? Is the Yes on 3 campaign mad at Mike Cann? Is that what I hear?
That's not what I'm trying to say. But what I am trying to say.
Go ahead.
I'm going to tell you a story about back from my Prop 19 days in California. I worked on the campaign to legalize marijuana in California in 2010. And back then, we had this guy, this black minister we affectionately referred to as Reverend Crackhead, who would just go out and say the craziest reefer madness swill you've ever heard speaking about no on Prop 19 during that campaign. So crazy, in fact, and so radical was the reefer madness stuff he was saying, was that the no on 19 campaign ended up disavowing him and not allowing him to events. What we at the Yes on 19 campaign being smart ended up doing is we got his phone number personally and started inviting him to debate us ourselves, and it worked out very well because every time he opened his mouth, he made everyone that voted Noah 19 look like a huge idiot. He made us look very smart. What I'm trying to say here to you, Mike Han, is that with all your publicity coming out here saying that Yes on 3 very publicly to all kinds of media is a gateway to legalization, I'm not saying it is or it isn't, or that it's a, that's a bad thing, because obviously we're all for the legalization of marijuana here, but I'm concerned, Mike, is that you are becoming the Reverend Crackhead for the
For the
No on 3 campaign. You should know that Heidi, one of the directors of the No on 3 campaign, has your literature in her binder, and when she goes to debates to debate the Yes on 3 people, she brings out your stuff and shows.
Wait, I'm going to stop you right there. This is the lady who is the Reverend Crackhead. So yep. you're like
I'm saying, like,
you know what, it's not even, you know what, I'm just going to call you out on that. That's okay. A bunch of bullshit.
All right.
That's this campaign. They attacked us. We responded. They look like fools. They look like fools in the letters to the editor. They've looked like fools in every piece of media that's come out. It's like, you know what? Like, if your opponent is attacking someone who's not even leading the campaign, who's in media, who's not officially with any campaign, you've lost. It's like, I have way more credibility. And for you to say, I almost want to say, get the fuck out of my studio, Alex, honestly, when you come in here with that bullshit. Yeah. So let's talk about the voter registration now.
Hey, hold on. This isn't
okay. No, I'm being serious. I'm serious. Like, dude, look at my videos. Let her put out my videos. Let her promote me.
Oh, they are.
There's no one. I get along with the governor. I get along with Dan Ray. I get along with Capuano. I have a relationship with Diane Russell. Like, you.
But
nobody.
The point that he's making, can you at least speak to that? I mean, the thought that you might be helping the others.
I'm telling you not. That's exactly what I'm saying. I'm saying, like, they're helping me. Let's be serious about what's happening going on right now.
That's definitely
these people
true.
Are going down 2-1. Mm. They are the crackheads.
It's true.
You know, stop playing pussy pants. What Matt Allen did on that last Fox 25 was exactly what needed to be done. He did it in a better, like, I felt for the longest time that someone like myself should have been out front. I was pissed off that they weren't running a campaign. I started running it through the media in a way. Matt Allen in that last interview did it the way it should be done. He did it very politely, but he got the last word, and he called them out on their bullshit. And that's all that we've done. And that's all that it's been reported in the media. Let them talk to their 50 reefer mad people and talk about Mike Han. I love it. Gives a shit?
What you're saying.
Let them focus on me.
Okay.
They're not focusing on winning. They're losing. I have every politician. I can list 100 politicians that I've moved myself, one person, compared to this whole group of people. Mm. And they've got like 1/10. Now, look at someone like Matt Allen, look at Whitney Taylor, look at the ACLU, look at Mass Can Normal, look at drug policy. There's no way we're going to lose. Mm. We are going to win legalization. Mm. And I never even said that. That was the whole point. You're not keeping up. And that's the other thing I'm going to call you out. I'm just saying. You got to let me. I mean, you said your piece. Now I want to go to voter registration. Mass Can Normal, through your group and Vote Mass, collected a bunch of voters.
Mm.
There was one person who, like, was ridiculous on Facebook saying that they didn't get registered. Chris Foy, I don't know if you saw that. Did you see what he posted?
No.
Chris Foy registered a vote at the event through you.
Mm.
He posted the letter he got from the town of Scituate that says he has registered a vote through you.
Mm.
So therefore, it's obvious to, I think, everybody that they were turned in on time.
Mm. They were.
That one person... Maybe even two, because she says there's somebody else, but she's not. This person that's complaining on Facebook has no town listed. She's not telling us what town she registered in.
Mm.
But she's going off on Mass Can. She's going off on you guys. But I think it's already been put to bed. Chris Foy got registered through you guys.
Yeah, a lot
you guys
of
have submitted
registered.
All the people who were registered.
I registered to vote that day.
There you go.
I my own voter registration form. Which
how many
is
people
I
do? And I saw the stack that you had. You had like how many?
400.
400.
Over 400.
And they were organized. Mm. This was way before the deadline. You sent in over 400?
Over 400. Yes.
No, I want to hear it for that. We have 400 new registered voters through the Freedom Rally, and somebody's bitching about that because they probably didn't fill it out right, or they were homeless and they got disenfranchised by the town clerk. Instead, they should be complaining about the town clerk and the city clerk and find out what happened and go against them and not against people collecting signature, collecting voters.
Yeah, well, here's the thing. When you're registering people to vote, there's so much that can be messed up on a voter registration form. You can forget to sign it. You can forget to date it. Almost everyone forgets to check the top two boxes that say you're an American citizen, that you're over 18 before November 6th. And you have to remind them to check those boxes. There's a lot going on. Not to mention you have to write legibly. This isn't on a computer. People are writing this by hand. So there's a lot that can go on a voter registration form. I'm sure there's, you know, maybe 20, 30, maybe more forms that were bad out of 400 forms, which is a lot. But if 95% of our voter registration forms were correct, then so that's great.
This
all
is someone,
volunteer
this
effort.
Is my issue with somebody on Facebook started complaining before they actually knew what was going on. And trying to make you guys look bad, and you guys did volunteer work. That pissed me off, actually, this week. Like, I don't get why people jump to conclusions. They should at least find out the minimum information.
Yeah, I haven't seen what's posted on Facebook myself. I'm not in this Facebook group. I looked on the MassCan Facebook page today, and I couldn't see anything.
You know, when
there.
You look, it's like someone else posts on MassCan's page, and it shows up in the comments.
It's not a comment on a MassCan post.
Yeah, it's on their own page.
Okay.
So I can't even comment on some of them. But Chris Foy, I think, handled it really well for MassCan.
Yeah, he posted
the letter, and it basically proved that he got registered through you guys, and you guys did submit the
hundreds of people were registered through us.
There you go. So yeah, put that to rest. I want to go to something else on question three.
Okay.
Question three. We were talking about this. They've been putting a lot of videos on this YouTube website that they have. I've been reposting a lot of those. Other people have been reposting them all over YouTube. They're getting a shitload of views. They're advertising on YouTube and through Google Ads. They're doing a lot of advertising. But we're not seeing radio, television ads. Are you hearing anything about that? Do you know anything?
No.
Okay.
I don't work for the campaign. I don't know their internal details.
I mean, before you said, oh, there's no money. But I took issue with that because I see that PSAs. And they have reported recently to have $600 in their bank account. And they're still putting out PSAs. They're pretty terrible PSAs, but at least they are doing. I've heard, there's the YouTube videos that have come out. And is that from the Mass Patients Alliance?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, they put out a lot of videos.
Yeah,
I know they're doing social media. You know, honestly, I think it's because they don't need to do it.
Yeah,
they're
going to
win by like 70%.
That's why I got so fired up earlier.
I'm willing to go back to that conversation with you too, Mikey, because there's more to be said about that.
All right, go back to it.
The thing is what you're saying, Mike, is that Yes on 3 is a step... It's just a step towards the eventual path of legalizing marijuana outright. Right? That's how you feel.
I'm not saying it's a step. You know, basically what I would say is that medical marijuana for a patient like myself, it helps.
It does.
And that's what's on the initiative right now.
Yeah.
Like, we only can do one question every 4 years. So basically what I'm saying is we're in a trend over the next 10 or 15 years where we're going to reform marijuana laws. And it's going to be, there'll be some hemp laws, maybe we'll just get complete repeal of prohibition. That's the end goal for a lot of us that we really want to see. But, you know, we'll pass what we can when we can. And the medical cannabis helps a lot of people.
Oh, yeah, and we're going to pass
happen.
It.
And I think that if you like legalization, I think there's a lot of people out there, and they're at the station. There are people at the station that I'm talking to, and basically they're voting no on medical cannabis, and they smoke weed because they want legalization.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of times when I'm trying to spread the word to them that if you really want legalization, you want medical to pass with the highest percentage.
Mm-hmm.
So you should vote yes on it. So it's like a 2 or 3 prong thing. It's like, you know, and I realize that the other side, they're going to say crazy shit no matter what.
They are.
So all we should do is laugh at them and call it out. And if you want to go hardball like I have and go make, I don't care. Mm. Like, I love it when they throw it back at me because I can go crazy on them.
No, all I'm saying is, like, at least they've interpreted your message. Maybe they've just totally misconstrued
what
you're saying.
They did. That was the whole point of it.
The problem.
They lied from the start. Like, basically, they put out a video, and Kevin said that the first video that they put out was that it was a big conspiracy to legalize cannabis.
It's not.
And that's exactly what I said. I said there are a bunch of people who've been working to legalize cannabis openly in the state. There's a separate group.
Yeah. But, well, let's be real here. It It is.
And we have
I'm not
the
afraid
numbers.
To say it. Not I put only the legalization PPQs yeah, on the
and
ballot.
That's exactly my
this
point.
This is a step
that's
towards
exactly
legalizing
what I said.
Marijuana.
You guys have
and
been.
This is going to push
and
us
that's
over
what
the
saying.
Edge.
Your organization exists. You've put on like 40
yeah.
PPQs.
I'm not afraid
you've
to say it.
You've won every single one
I'm
of
not
them.
Afraid to
you
say it.
You have 62 voters. We have 62% voter support for legalization. We have mm-hmm. more support for legalization than we do medical right now.
No, it's not that. It's not
it
that
is.
Much.
It is. It's
got
to
be like 70% support for medical.
No, well, last poll was 59.
I don't
and last for legal was 62. So,
I don't believe all
so
the polls.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's like, who knows which higher, really? We won't know until the votes happen.
They could be neck and neck. I don't know. Medical has to be. The
so,
point
it's like, so it's like their whole case was bunk. And that's all I said. And then they attacked me with the lie that you, all these lies,
mm-hmm.
saying all this crap. And I just laughed. I mean, you know, let's call them out on their lies, was my point. I showed up at their event and I told Kevin Sabe that, all right, so you said you have a problem with cannabis leaf because it's now 10% THC. Well, THC is 100%. You just told me I should take THC. You're worried about me getting high on 10% THC. You said
it's higher than 10%. It's not even that good weed.
I know,
days.
But you know what I'm saying? Maybe it's 15.
Yeah. Maybe
compared
it's
to 100? He wants me on 100. Mm. And he just complained about THC.
Well, they want you on a synthetic pharmaceutical product that's patented.
There you go.
Yep. Speaking of which,
insane
speaking of which,
for a pharmaceutical industry.
That is what I wanted to talk about
yes.
with the Yes on 3 campaign. It's
Let's
a perfect segue
that.
Because it's the cover of the Phoenix this week is a story. It's called Welcome to Oxychusetts,
yeah.
and it is talking about Massachusetts' increase in opiate overdoses, increase in people going to rehab, 530-something percent increase in Massachusetts of people going to rehab for opiate addictions, for OxyContin addictions, and that this is a good thing for big pharmaceuticals, obviously. And that just the history of how it was pushed on doctors and just straight out lies, and the people who lied have admitted it. And they said, yeah, you know, we just told them, no, there's no possibility
hey, was that
for
FDA,
abuse.
Heather, was that FDA approved?
Yeah.
This is not what the Yes on 3.
Absolutely.
No on 3 campaign just talks about is that we need FDA approval.
Well, they were fine. The pharmaceutical company that created the Oxy 80s was fined like $300 million for
right.
distributing them because they were so abusable. But at the same time, they should have realized they were so abusable.
Oh, they did realize it. That's
ago.
The thing. Yeah. They lied
under
about it.
Under FDA approval.
And this is what they're saying we need.
No abuse happens under the FDA.
Right. And it's just mind-boggling. And of course, in all of these No on 3 conversations have centered around the children and the addiction of marijuana and how so many kids are going to rehab for marijuana, which obviously they're coerced into doing instead of getting jail time, and they choose to go to rehab instead, because who would choose to go to jail instead? Probably very few. But in the case of OxyContin, I mean, the rehab costs, I'm sure, skyrocketing. People who are overdosing all the time. I mean, this was huge in Somerville, like, over the past, like, decade or so.
And going to heroin.
And, and going to heroin because OxyContin's too expensive.
Yeah.
And this is all part of the plot. I mean, it's like our drugs are great, and we can lie and all, you know, whatever we need to say to get it overprescribed to people. And meanwhile, marijuana has no medical value.
And that's the thing. Like, marijuana is the lighter substance. Like, Oxy
oh my
is
God,
much stronger.
Of course. Unbelievable.
Why don't we give them the lighter substance? If someone has pain, let's see if cannabis works first. If it
but
doesn't,
cannabis isn't addictive like that. It doesn't make them the same type of money over the lifetime of abusing the drugs. And meanwhile, this comes out in the same week I read an article that was
and they
physically,
can't patent cannabis.
It was sickening.
They only get part. That's the thing that Kevin Sabet and these other jokers always want to ignore, is that they can't patent all of the cannabis plant and all the different strains. Cannabis is like wine. There's so many different strains, and the cannabinoids and how much are in there determine what kind of strain you have. And they can't patent it. All they
unless
can do
you
is,
genetically engineer it.
Yeah, they could genetically
Monsanto
engineer
weed.
But even that, they only could do like certain molecules, like the THC and the cannabinoids. They can't. Then they could do their own mixtures, but it's not the same as the leaf. The leaf is natural substance. They can't patent it. They can't.
They could only patent it if it was genetically engineered, like
even,
a Monsanto patent.
Even that, though, they're not going to be able to genetically engineer my friggin' kush that I have in my hand.
No.
They can't. It's not allowed.
And that's dangerous because, you know, this is, you know, something like oxycodone, OxyContin, that is patentable and it's mass producible and it's gonna, you know, enslave people in the addiction to it and the side effects from it. And it's mind blowing. And meanwhile, I just read an article that goes along with this that is talking about the prescription of ADHD medication, the disproportionate prescription of ADHD medication to children in low-income communities. Okay? Because of low test scores, they're giving them all Ritalin and Adderall at early ages so that they can do better on tests. And they know it, and the teachers know it, and the parents know it, and the kids know it, and they're doing it anyway because that is what's the most important now is how well you do on a test, on a standardized test, and your health, your mental health, your well-being, your physical health as a child, the evolution of your brain is worth sacrificing.
I would rather have a brownie than ADHD. Like, I think if a kid can take a cannabis brownie.
Yeah, and that was another article that was talking
instead
about
of
this.
That pill?
Cannabis as a therapeutic medicine
not
for
smoking
children.
It. I wouldn't have any kids.
That's
smoking
in the Boston weed. Globe
I mean, it's
this
really
week, actually.
Serious medical condition, but like for ADHD, I think that they've shown like that the medical hemp brownies can really have a big effect.
And children are just being, I mean, the assault on children is huge in terms of the pharmaceutical industry. And children as young as 3 being diagnosed with depression and being put on mood stabilizers, you know, at the critical period of
Isn't
brain
it crazy
development.
How that, you've worked with kids.
Yeah.
I worked around kids for a little while. And I worked at different high schools. I was a coach. I was a substitute. I was a regular teacher. I also worked at a group home. I did overnights. And the thing about the kids in the youth home, it was boys. It was troubled youth boys away from there. It was what do you call those group homes? Almost like DYS.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing like that you notice so quickly is how many pills.
Yeah.
They have these kids on. Every morning they got to line up and they're taking like 5-6 pills.
Yeah.
And the kids are like 13, 14 years old, like. How is pills just the answer to everything?
It's unbelievable. And you know, whereas cannabis could be used as a therapeutic medicine with little to no, you know, risk of addiction.
And the people you're giving them to, too.
Yeah.
Like, let's talk about those kids.
But that's so like taboo kids, and controversial,
those
too.
Kids are the kids that have the worst families, that have the most issues. I mean, I was around these kids. They had family members who were rapists. They had some of them had been raped.
They have mental
illness. Some of them were rapists. You know, or going to be rapists. Some of them were, you know, like the one kid I remember. His mom. He was a nice kid, but he loved his mom. But she was a junkie too.
And you instead know, of giving these kids services and support,
we give them pills
and therapy and safe places to learn and a path. You know, meanwhile, we have them on pills.
And yes. I'm not against pills. I mean, I think pills help a lot of people, and I think that my father is in mental health, and he's all about the pills. And I think that the pills are a good short-term bridge for a lot of people.
But
I think
children.
They're overprescribed, especially to children, and I think that they're forcing them. Like, that's the only solution. You know, they still do therapy and all these other things, but it's bigger than that. It's a culture. It's like we talked about. How do you cure some of these things? You can't cure our rape with pills.
No, exactly. Exactly. I mean, I just think, especially working with kids, and I do see that.
Cannabis is such a nice wedge because it takes the edge off, but it doesn't make you addicted. It doesn't change your future behavior, especially if it's in a brownie form. I feel if you give a child a brownie, it's not.
But this is mind-blowing commentary. This is totally controversial.
But if you give a kid
incomprehensible to think about giving a child with bipolar disorder or ADHD.
A hemp brownie.
And there's
it's okay to give them how many what we call antipsychotic. Anti anxiety. All these pills that they give them.
That are dubious, you know, the
I'm
claims
more afraid
of their success
those.
Are totally dubious. All this stuff is fudged. I mean, these guys, like you said, went to federal court. You know, for pushing this drug, and it's still out there, and it's like, and that's totally still acceptable. It's mind blowing, and kids are being made. The kids, there's an article on Alternet talking about kids being hooked for life. And do we have a call coming in right now? Is
that
what that is?
No, I think we're just about wrapping up.
Oh, okay, we're wrapping up. Well, I thought I saw
that's
that.
That's all right. No,
But yeah, it pisses me off. I mean, it's really infuriating. And I want to say we really need, you know, compassionate medicine and sane medicine. But we also need to take away and call into question the system of over-prescribing dangerous, really dangerous drugs. And
absolutely.
And what is our government doing? What are our resources doing?
And what is
prioritizing shutting down weed clinics?
What is the Mass Prevention Alliance saying about this?
Yeah.
What is No One Question 3 saying about this? Yeah. What is Dr. Kevin Sabet saying about this?
Yeah, exactly.
What is Heidi Heilman saying about this? Have they talked about these issues? No.
Think of the children.
Think of the children. They don't think about the children.
Nope.
They want the children to run the marijuana trade in the schools. That's what prohibition does.
If you vote
does.
Yes on 3, all your children will start smoking marijuana.
They already do. A lot of the kids are smoking weed. They're selling it. They're the ones who sell
it. I'm sorry, guys.
And yeah, we had a
I hate to break it to you.
It's true. We had a volunteer in the Yes on 3 office today. This kid was 15 calling up people, trying to get people to come out and help out for Yes on 3. He was talking about the most recent drug bust in his school, in his high school. This kid's 15. A pound and a half of weed in his high school.
So that's under prohibition. And you know what? Like, they'll say, oh, it's because of decrim. No. Massachusetts had the highest teen marijuana use in the country before decrim. And it's because we've prohibited it. You're not seeing them, you're not seeing cases of cigarettes being brought out of the high school. You're not seeing cases of beer, kegs of beer brought out of the high school. You're seeing pounds of weed.
Pounds of weed.
These kids in a recession, they can't find jobs. You know what they're doing? They're selling high-end weed to each other. This is the market. This is even, like, it used to happen when I was in high school. High school kids had easier access to weed when I was in high school than beer and cigarettes and all these other things. Now it's even gotten worse because the prices have gone up. So it's totally incentivized. The high-end weed that everyone wants is the cool status thing. This is what the kids are doing. They're selling it to each other. And Heidi and them don't seem to ever want to acknowledge this, the Vote No on Question 3 campaign. They claim the children, but they're not about the children.
And we are. Two hotheads is.
We got to thank everyone this week. Thank everyone for coming in. Especially, I got to get it right this week. Rob Kaufman behind the board. We want to thank him big time.
Yeah.
He's been doing, he's been here how many weeks now? Three weeks? Four weeks?
Four weeks.
Yeah. Oh. We lose track because it's been great.
Seamless.
I love
seamless.
Him. Yeah.
Works well.
Thank you for doing the show.
And of course, our old producer
Newman,
forever friend.
Did you have to say old?
No, you're Newman.
You're looking younger though, actually. Like when you left here, you were kind of we. I don't know what was wrong.
We
like,
broke you down.
Yeah. Now you're like you've come back. You're like, oh yeah, I'm kicking ass. Looking good, Newman.
Thank you.
And we also have Alex in here.
Yep.
Alex.
And
I hope I didn't upset you too much.
No, no. You know what?
We'll hash it out after. After we go.
I want to thank you because that needed to be come out.
It needed to be said. No, you cleared your name.
Needed to be discussed.
Yeah, they're warping your message.
I have that own concern myself. Like, let it be known. I think that myself. But
good.
When I weigh it all out. It's like, it's a joke.
I know. Keep doing what you're doing, man. Yeah. I'm not saying don't do what you do. Just be aware.
I do.
You know,
I'm glad to know. I'm glad to know more, too, that I thought they had kind of dropped it when we went after them a little hard, a bunch of us. But it's very interesting that they're still they're not letting it go.
No, they just say,
she's got a hat on for Mike Cannon.
If you vote yes on 3, they'll legalize marijuana next. This is Mike Cannon.
Sound
I'm not
argument.
Saying it's your fault. That's what they're saying.
That's kind of a nice compliment, man. You should take that.
I think she likes me.
I think so too.
Heidi, we'll have a drink later.
Once this is all over,
you know, that's the other thing. Kevin Sabet and I are going out for coffee after we've made an agreement after the campaign.
Oh my god!
Might even, you know what? I'm thinking honestly, we might do like you know the Heads versus Feds tour. Kevin versus Mike Cannon.
Yeah, what's his name? Timothy Leary toured with the Nixon guy.
But I don't know, Kevin. We'll see. Yeah. Kevin's pissed at me, so we'll see. We'll see if he'll do it. I would go on tour with him.
That'd be good.
Well, and I won't tour with anybody. I'll tour with him because he got me going.
All right, two hotheads. Another week's gone.
Overtime
flown
again.
By. Overtime.
Thank you on regular radio.
As always, and we'll see you next week.
And thanks for all our callers and our guests, Jim Gray and
And Raya from
CPN.
The
CPN.
Yep, yeah. Yep, exactly.
And our callers, Big Nick.
Yeah, thank Big you for, Nick.
Thanks. And Peter's page.
Yeah.
Julia.
Julia, yep, we had a great show.
And Carmelita and everybody else, thank you, love you.
And God
thanks for,
and the devil. And
yeah. Instant feedbacks, too, you know. Thank you, Nikki. And now, yeah,
next all right, week. See you next week. Two Hotheads, only on UnregularRadio.com.
Wanted to talk about yesterday's show. You probably just heard the video on YouTube, and this is going on right after it. You heard Alex Arsenault from the Drug Policy Forum of Massachusetts, who are working on public policy questions to legalize cannabis. You heard him speak. He also is helping out with the Yes on Question 3 campaign. His words that, you know, he used against myself and kind of pushing me, he was questioning me, that comes from one person. That comes from Matt Allen. And it comes from behind Matt Allen is a group called the Dewey Square Group. They're running the Question 3 campaign, the Yes on Question 3. I'm actually really disappointed in Matt Allen. I'm just going to say it. Someone that I've supported a lot, I've done a lot of work for their group in the past, and working to bring the legalization movement and the medical people together, because there is kind of a rift there. I've also worked to help them out when there was a big controversy among the patients when they were drafting the initiative. A lot of the patients didn't like the language. They wanted it to be less restrictive. I understand why the initiative is so restrictive. I haven't attacked that. I understand the campaign is the way it is. I haven't attacked that. I've supported them. However, I do have an issue today. My issue is the way they're dealing with myself. I'm somebody that's out here. I'm always going to be out here. I've got listeners. I've got credibility. I've worked with more public elected officials than anyone else in the state. I've moved more elected officials. I can list them. The governor of Massachusetts I recently talked to, I think I moved him a bit. I moved even Scott Brown. I moved Capuano to sign the repeal of prohibition, Congressman Capuano. I've worked with so many state reps and state senators. Look at our show. I mean, we have Diane Russell, the main state rep, on regularly on our show. We have Judge Jim Gray running for vice president regularly on our show. We have Gary Johnson regularly on our show. We've had Bonnie Frank on our show. We've had so many public officials, and in state, and state, you know, we have State Senator Rosenberg coming on next week. How many state officials? I can't even keep count. There's so many state reps and state officials that I have talked to and moved that I've lost count. I have a list on my MikeCanNet website that is very long, and it's just, you know, probably shows a quarter of the people I've actually talked to and moved. So that's my history. I've been successful. I've done the work. I've also helped Mass Patients Advocacy Alliance, and specifically Matt Allen. There's been a lot of, in the past, kind of a rift between the legalizers in the state and the people who want medical marijuana. Matt Allen and his group are definitely all about medical marijuana. I don't actually believe that they care about legalization. I don't believe that they're about that, and they're definitely not about it during this campaign period. And I can understand that and respect it. However, respect me. Respect what I'm doing. I've done nothing but help you guys. And ever since this little controversy has come up with vote no on question 3, Matt Allen hasn't called me. He used to call me all the time. He used to talk to me all the time. He doesn't call me anymore. Matt Allen hasn't responded to any of my emails. You know what, Matt Allen? What I've heard from you now is through other people is a little whisper campaign against me, trying to hit up my credibility. Why? Why? I question that. The reason why, I think, is because you know that there's somebody out there that's independent that will not cave in for your political shenanigans. Like, I'm not putting up with it. Like, you know, you want me to stay silent. You don't want me to talk about legalization. You don't want me to be doing the work that I'm doing. You want me to leave it all to your group. And you know what? That's just not the way I operate. I am a one-man show. I'm going to continue to be a one-man show. Deal with it. Deal with it. And the other thing that, you know, is kind of infuriating me is here I am a medical patient. I just told the truth. I told the truth as it exists for myself. I called them out on their reefer mad bullshit, on their lies. And I was right. And they responded and they attacked and they looked like fools. And everybody knows they look like fools. If you look at the YouTube comments, if you look at my subscriber counts, if you look at what's happened, I've been proven to be right. They've been proven to be wrong. That is the public reaction. It's there's no doubt about it. There's not even a doubt. There's not a shred of evidence to show that I'm losing this little battle. And what did you do? You were the only people besides the No on Question 3 campaign who have actually said anything negatively against me on this. And you didn't do it publicly. You did it privately. You did a little whisper campaign, which I think is really weak. If you have something to say about myself, say it publicly. Say it publicly. You know, I know and you know that if this was really a concern for the campaign, how easy would it be for you to put out something? Well, Mike Cann doesn't represent us. He's not working with us. He is a medical patient that supports medical, but he also supports legal, so we're not working with him. How easy would that be? That's exactly what I told the press. The press knows. The press isn't shading it that I'm working for you guys. You guys could say that, but you're not going to say that because you know it doesn't matter. You don't want to give me any press. That's the real issue here, isn't it, Matt? That somebody that is not with your campaign is getting a lot of press. Somebody not with your campaign isn't sticking to your script. Well, that's too bad. You don't control all the citizens of Massachusetts. I'm a citizen. I'm speaking for the citizens that I work with. I'm representing a bunch of citizens, just like you represented a bunch of citizens. You know, Matt, I don't agree with a lot of things that you guys are saying and doing, but I don't sit there and bash you guys because I know that you do represent patients. I don't even bash you privately. This is the first time I've ever said anything bad about you, and I'm doing it publicly because I didn't like what went down on that show. And you guys didn't look good. You came at me with somebody who's actually on my side. Alex Arsenault supports legalization. He's working for your campaign. He's helping the medical. He's just like myself, really, politically. He agrees with medical. He agrees with legal. And Alex came at me not knowing all the full information. He hadn't watched all the videos. He hadn't read all the newspaper stories. He didn't really know. Why did he bring this up? Because he was getting a one-sided conversation from Matt Allen, who he respects, someone who's leading a big campaign. And after that conversation, he thought he would bring it to me on my radio show. And he brought it, and I brought it back. And in the end, what did Alex do? Alex said the same exact things that I said in my video that Matt Allen found so objectionable that he's got to whisper about it. Well, Matt, now you got to whisper about Alex Arsenault because now he said the same things that I've said in video on my radio show that you sent him to speak to me about. I mean, talk about ridiculousness. You guys are paying the Dewey Square Group $1 million to run this campaign. You should have given Mike Cann $1,000. I would have won with more percentage points. You know, the one thing recently that I saw that I really liked on Matt Allen is that he finally went at Heidi Heilman. Heidi Heilman looked like a fool on Fox 25. She was interrupting. She was rude. She looked like a typical uptight soccer mom that just didn't know when to quit. And at the very end, Matt Allen got the last word. What did Matt Allen say? Matt Allen said, no matter what kind of initiative, what kind of law we put out for medical marijuana, the group, No on Question 3, will always find a way. They'll always find something to complain about because they just don't want medical cannabis to go to patients. And that is the truth. And that's what I've been saying the whole time. And that's what you guys got to go back harder at No on Question 3 because they've been lying. They are disingenuous. They called us disingenuous. Why the silence from Yes on Question 3? What are you afraid of? You're going to win this campaign. You know who you're going to need after the campaign? You're going to need Mike Cann. You're going to need my show that you boycotted, that you won't come on, that you're now whispering campaign against us. You're going to need us, and you're alienating us. Wake up. Choose the community over the Dewey Square Group. Choose patients like myself over your political campaign that you're going to win no matter what. Stick up for patients. Fight back against No on Question 3 craziness. Who's the real enemy here?
We're going to debate this question. In support of Question 3 from our Beacon Hill studio, that's Matt Allen right there. He's the executive director for the Massachusetts Patient Advocacy Alliance and the spokesperson for CompassionForPatients.com. Joining us here in Dedham, this is Heidi Heilman. She is the president of the Massachusetts Prevention Alliance and a spokesperson for MAVoteNoOnQuestion3.com. You are opposed to ballot question number three. Thank you both for being here. I really appreciate it and talking a little closer about this issue. We've been picking this question apart for days, so let's get right into it. Recreational use. So you're saying that it's not strict enough. What
not
do you say
at
that
all. We have, you know, this law would allow anyone 21 years of age or older to own and operate a pot shop, regardless of their education. They don't even have
to have a
high school diploma.
Go ahead, Matt. Why don't you continue? Go ahead.
Well, I mean, first of all, when we look at the other states like Colorado and California, those are states we've looked at and looked at the lessons learned and addressed those issues. There are 1,000 dispensaries in L.A. There's over 500 in Denver, like Heidi said. That's why in our proposal, we require the state to open a minimum of 14 treatment centers, but no more than 35. So
in
immediately that's
going
to crack down on some of the issues of implementation we've seen in other states, but where people are like, with a system that's so widespread, couldn't there be a Blues?
But that's in the first year. This law would allow more pot stores to come in future years, and are underfunded. Public health department would have to oversee this infrastructure, and there's no sales tax on any marijuana sales if this passes. So
everybody who's
purchasing marijuana, it's a nonprofit system. So we're going to have the taxpayers paying for the public health department to oversee and regulate this new unique pharmaceutical system that is circumvents our entire medical. Our medical infrastructure and our pharmaceutical infrastructure, and this is just not the way we do medicine. Everybody has compassion for the chronically ill. I'm going to a funeral this weekend where a woman just died from breast cancer.
True. It's designed to be revenue neutral, and the system will be paid for by licensing fees. I would also like to... Excuse me, Heidi.
We have people in California in these pot stores that don't even they call their sales donations. That's how people are circumventing the entire structure of how we do business in this country.
Okay, we're getting a little ahead. I just wanted to address.
Well, we have 1 minute left, so go ahead.
Well, it's not true that anyone 21 years old will be able to open one of these treatment centers. It'll be a very rigorous licensing process.
And what's the licensing process, Matt?
And I would
tell
also
me what that looks like.
Well. The initiative sets out the framework for the program, and a lot of the specifics will be addressed in the regulatory phase. But one point I would like to make is that when we look at these conditions that people have, the opponents want to have it both ways. On one hand, they'll point to all the conditions that I mentioned and said, oh, that individual should have access to medical marijuana, but they object to the language that would cover these patients. In fact, the opponents are opposed to medical marijuana reform on principle. And anything that we put forward, they're going to try to nitpick out regulations because they don't want to see patients have safe access.
I'm going to have to stop you both right there. Excellent on both sides. Appreciate it.